Hi, and welcome to this installment of Frank and Mary here in Nantucket. Usually, Allison Forsgren is right here with me as my co-host for these shows, but she is back on in America with somebody at one of the hospitals in Boston, and therefore could not make it today. If you haven't seen the show before, I am an attorney. I'm an elder law attorney. I work at a firm called Myrick O'Connell. There are 70 of us there. I do nothing but elder law. I do presentations here at the Salt Marsh, and they're more about law. But these presentations, Frank and you've, if you've seen the presentations, I'm always talking about Frank and Mary, my friends Frank and Mary, and their kids Peter, Paul, and Mary Jr. I always say if you're old enough to get the joke, you're old enough to be my client. And their goal is to live in their house until they die and be buried in the backyard. So the question for Frank and Mary in Nantucket is, how can they do that? What are the people and the programs and the services that they need to know about that are here that can help them, or that if they're not here, they should be advocating for so that they can live in their house until they die? So one of those kinds of services is a so-called memory cafe. A memory cafe, broadly defines a place where folks can go if they've got memory loss, or they can go with their loved one who's got memory loss and be comfortable. But to further explain that, I invited a guest, my friend Erin Kopecki. Thank you very much for coming on.
Thank you for having me.
So we're going to talk a little bit about memory cafes. First, I'm just going to have you talk a little bit about your day job and how you ended up here. And then we're going to talk about memory cafes, and then we'll talk a little more about your day job. Okay?
Yeah.
So what are you doing here? How did you get... are you homegrown? How did you get to Nantucket?
I'm technically a wash ashore, is what they would call you here in Nantucket. I moved here in October 2015, so a little over 3 years ago.
Yeah.
And I moved here to work at the nursing home,
Our Island Home.
Yes. And I went there to eventually become the administrator there.
Yeah. And what had you done before that? Was it, what kind of led you to
prior to that, I was working at a home care agency called Best of Care, headquartered in Quincy.
Yeah.
And then I also worked at two low-income senior housing properties in Boston area.
And is this kind of, did you go to school for this kind
of
stuff?
I did. I went to undergrad and grad school for gerontology and management.
I see. So you've been interested in working with seniors like for a long time.
Yes. I was very close to my grandmother as a young girl. Started volunteering at nursing homes when she passed away, and then didn't know that there was a major known as gerontology, so I decided to go on that path, and I love it.
And you know, it's been my experience that that's about three quarters of the people who are in gerontology, it's because they had a grandmother or they had a grandfather, and they were really close to them, and they said, wow, I really want to do this.
Yeah.
So that's really cool. So you ended up coming out here, and you just kind of showed up, and at that time, who were you working with at that time?
I was working with Best of Care.
With Best of Care.
Yeah.
And you're still doing that?
Yeah. So after leaving the nursing home, I started Tucked In Elder Care.
Yeah.
It's a geriatric care management business on Island.
Yeah.
And I am affiliated with Best of Care, who I used to work for. They're a home care agency. Yeah. They also have an office in Dennis. And so we're working together to provide home care services and geriatric care management services
and
to
I
our
want,
seniors.
Because after we're done talking about... memory cafe. See, my memory's going too. About memory cafes, I want to talk a little bit about that because often at the Salt Marsh presentations, I've talked about how important it is to have a geriatric care manager if you're a senior. There's one that who was on Martha's Vineyard who was kind of the person, and I kept saying, "Why is there no one here?" You know.
Yeah.
So we'll talk about that. So let's get to memory cafes.
Okay.
So what is it? What led you to be interested in memory cafes, and what are they? And it's my understanding that there may be one coming and that there are a lot of people really focusing on that. So start off with, what is it and how did you get interested?
So I learned more about it through Allison Forsgren and Rachel Day. Rachel Day is the Director of Human Services for the town of Nantucket.
Yeah.
I worked with her at the nursing home.
Because she was the administrator there before she started doing that stuff. Yeah.
And so they told me a little bit about it. I have heard... about it before because I know that there are multiple memory cafes throughout the state of Massachusetts.
A lot.
Yeah.
A lot. As a matter of fact, at the Elder Expo, the person who started the first one actually did a presentation, and I think she did our last show.
Yeah, Tammy.
Yeah, Tammy Pozzerick.
Yeah.
She's
great,
but no one can pronounce her name. She's
terrific.
So go ahead.
So I think it's so important for Nantucket to be involved in the dementia-friendly community initiative that's growing throughout the United States. And to begin that, we're trying to incorporate a memory cafe. So this will allow those living with dementia and their caregivers and loved ones to come to a cafe within the town and feel comfortable with each other, kind of like a support group and doing activities as well, being around others that are experiencing the same disease process as you, because you don't really understand how difficult Alzheimer's or any other type of dementia can be until you are faced with it.
By the way, can you just, so for purposes of kind of reminding folks, so is Alzheimer's and dementia the same thing?
So dementia is kind of the umbrella term, and Alzheimer's is a type or form of dementia underneath the umbrella.
Ends up giving one Lewy of the diseases.
That, and, yeah.
I see.
So I know, it's a little confusing.
So it's for folks who have memory loss, right? Mm-hmm. And also for their caregivers, and does it have to be in a cafe? You say it's a memory
cafe. It doesn't. So some people have them at the senior centers.
Yeah.
Some have them in restaurants, and they do more of a meal, a dinner, or a lunch. We are trying to do it in a cafe rather than a senior community, just to get everyone out and about and feel like they can go into the community and feel comfortable. That's our main goal. We also hope to provide entertainment, whether it's someone singing, providing poetry, a presentation on maybe the fish around Nantucket.
There's a million things.
A place for people to chat and chat amongst themselves. We hope to run it at least once a month to start, and then we would love to do it twice a month or even once a week.
And when you're thinking about this, and from the research that you've done, how long does a memory cafe session last?
Usually an hour and a half, 2 hours. Because I'm sure not everyone gets there right at 11 o'clock.
Right.
With the sun downing, it's important to schedule it more so in the afternoon before lunch. And if we do it around lunch, maybe we can offer a meal.
Depending on how your fundraising goes.
Yeah.
So I remember I had seen you because Allison had actually gathered a group of people together kind of as an initial working group to start talking about that.
Yeah.
Can you just kind of talk about that a little
bit? So there's a committee that is made up of Rachel Day, so someone from the town. You were there as the elder law attorney.
I was there as the out-of-town person.
Person. The assistant director at the homestead was there. And then also just some community members who are experiencing this and facing this disease process. So we were speaking about it, and the main thing that they said that they needed was a coordinator to coordinate the Memory Cafe. And then I realized this is something I could absolutely do to help the community out. So I spoke to Allison and Rachel about it, and it looks like I'm going to be the lucky one.
Well, that's because I left before the end, and I only found out afterwards that you would kind of said, well, okay, you know, and that's great.
Yeah.
That's really exciting. And you're going to be looking to do fundraising in order to try to support this, which is also terrific. And I think many of the people in the room were saying they'd be happy to, you know, contribute and stuff.
Yeah,
because
you were,
I remember through the conversation, this wasn't sounding like this is like a huge amount of money per year to run one of these things, right?
Right, and then we're hoping too, maybe some of the Nantucket businesses out here would like to adopt or host a cafe, a monthly cafe, which really isn't, it's not a large
to be one
budget.
Of the, yeah. Right. So I'm mentioning this because those who people who may be watching, but that may be getting a phone call from one of us begging for money, I just wanted to kind of know up front that we may be calling. So that's a really, and if all goes well, when are you hoping this will start?
We would like to start at 2019, so hopefully we have one up and running by January.
That's great. And I remember at the presentation that Tammy Pozzerichi was at, Joe Adair was there, and I remember him standing up and saying, there's going to be a memory cafe, and Joe's been so active, I know, I always get the initials wrong, the entity that owns the building where the salt marsh is, right?
Yeah.
And so it's very exciting to see that kind of momentum for this.
Yeah.
So that's all terrific. So you're hoping that this kind of fits into more broadly this notion of creating a dementia-friendly community. Mm-hmm. Can you just give me your sense of what that means? What is a dementia-friendly community? Sounds great, then people go, but what?
So there are the 10 signs of dementia or Alzheimer's. And we hope, I don't want to put words in Rachel and Allison's mouth.
No, I'm asking, but I'm asking you. I'm asking you.
But we hope to train everyone throughout the community about how to interact with those facing this disease. It's so important because we want them to not have to feel like they have to hide in their homes now that they're faced with this disease, and that they can go out and still enjoy. You can still have a high quality of life when you're diagnosed with any type of dementia.
Right.
And then I don't know if you've heard of the purple table reservation.
As an example. No, talk a little bit about that.
So.
Oh, because our friend, our friend the chef.
Does he know about that?
Well, we were just talking after the show because he had come on before he did the presentation at the Elder Expo.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, so Purple Table, it's getting restaurants involved in the dementia-friendly community initiative. You train their staff, and you, if a family has a loved one with dementia, they can call and say, we'd like to make a reservation for 5 of us Thursday night, and they know to make it towards the earlier side. They may have
be a huge crowd.
Yeah, they may have a certain table that's set away in a corner, so it's a little bit more quiet.
Not necessarily a purple table, by the way.
Not when
people
purple.
People hear that, they go, we got to sit at a purple table.
Purple is a color for Alzheimer's. And then they may even have certain menus, so the menus aren't so confusing, and there's only a few options to choose from. And then the wait staff understand that somebody at that table has dementia. And
so they know how to interact with them.
Yeah.
I always talk when I think about that, because you know my kind of deaf. The way I think about a dementia-friendly community is one where no matter how confused I get, I can still kind of be in town. I can be, I'm not just in my house, I'm not just isolated in my house. I can make my house safe, but if I can't go out because I'm too embarrassed, what's the point, right? And to me, the restaurant example is such a good example because, you know, you go to a restaurant, you get these menus, it's got 50 items, you know. I don't want a 50-item menu. I want, Mr. Bergeron, today, would you like the chicken or the fish today?
Right, exactly.
Or even better, you know, Mr. Bergeron, you were here last week and you had the chicken. Would you like the chicken again? And so now I can say, yeah, I'd really like the chicken.
Yeah.
And now I feel really good about that, you know, and I didn't feel stupid,
exactly.
You know. So the idea of these very kind of easy things, as long as people become aware so they can kind of, you know, kind of see somebody who may be showing the symptoms. Mm-hmm. And kind of know what to say, right? So that's a terrific thing.
I think it's a great thing.
That's a terrific thing.
Yeah.
So now go back and tell me a little bit more about your day job, because I know you've talked about, because you're really pumped up about this.
I'm very excited about
elder care. And as I've told people, once again, I have to tell people, this isn't an ad, right? I'm not getting a commission. But this role, having a geriatric care manager available to help people figure stuff out, is just really important. So tell about that. What is a geriatric care manager?
So Tucton Elder Care, geriatric care management. I started working on it in April, but it didn't really launch until August. So it's still quite new. And geriatric care management, it's...
What does it mean?
In a way, kind of consulting, concierge service, helping families and their loved ones navigate through the aging process, because I don't think they don't make anything easier when you get older.
No.
Yeah. Like you're retired and you're like, I'm done. And now you have to go through all these insurances and it becomes very, very difficult.
And there's no like one, it isn't like you're a little kid and you just go to school.
Right.
And everything's at school, right?
Yeah.
This is not one-stop shopping, right?
Yeah.
You're a senior and there's like 5-10 different people you have to know and agencies and what do you do?
Exactly. Right? And then there are a lot of entitlement programs out there, but the seniors and families don't know about them, and how do they get that information? So my role, I am I'm an advocate for the client and family. I work for them, and I assess the client holistically. So it's not all about their medical needs.
That sounds very zen. You assess them all, right?
So I'd go into their homes and I provide a functional assessment, psychosocial, environmental, look at where they're living, a safety assessment. And then I provide them with a written out care plan, and it's kind of a roadmap as to where to go in the aging process. What do they need when it comes to home care? Do they really need 24/7, or would they be fine just having a few hours in the morning to help them get dressed and bathe, and then a few hours at night?
Because often seniors don't think of that. You know, you start thinking, oh my God, I don't want to do home care because it's going to cost me just a boatload of money. Right. And on an hourly basis, it can cost a lot, right? But when you start thinking out your day, how much of your day do you really need assistance with?
Right.
And a lot of times that's not all. There's pieces of it that you couldn't be there without somebody. But for the rest of the day, you can kind of be fine.
Yeah, if you're sitting there watching your news,
you don't need somebody else to watch the TV. Exactly.
So.
Exactly.
Yeah. And then there are a lot of seniors out here who have family that come for the summer, but then they end up going back to their hometown.
Right.
So just having a set of eyes and the family having somebody to call and saying, "Do you mind checking in on my mom or dad? I just want to make sure that they're safe and that their fridge is cleaned out," because oftentimes, I know I do it myself, you leave old food in there.
And you leave stuff, yeah.
Making sure that they're getting adequate nutrition. And then going to different events within the community, going to the senior center, going to the memory cafe, being social is such a huge.
And maybe going with them to some of those.
Yeah, absolutely.
Or being able to suggest that they have someone go with them to those events.
Yeah, and I can accompany individuals to doctor's appointments, go to Boston if a family member can't do that, take off work.
Yeah.
I did just speak to a woman who had an appointment in Cape Cod, and she didn't know what to do about transportation. So I gave her all these options. Obviously, some are more costly than others. And then I had a light bulb, and I spoke to Kevin, the president and COO of Best of Care, and I said, we need to get some sort of transportation available on island and off.
Regularly.
Yeah, so when people need to get to the doctor's appointments and do the door-to-door, so you know that they got to the doctor appointment okay and that they're in good hands, because no one wants to go to the doctors by themselves.
So based on kind of how you've seen that, because now you've been here for a few years, you've been kind of understanding it. So first of all, as far as home care folks are concerned, what is your sense? Are there enough folks here?
Mm-hmm.
And how do you deal with summer versus the rest of the year, right? Because that's kind of a constant. I remember talking to my friend Sandy Cordolby, who's the kind of the geriatric care manager on Martha's Vineyard. Uh-huh. And she said, winter's okay, but summer's, when you can clean houses for $30 an hour under the table. I know, so that's to say under the right, but under the table, how can you compete with that? So I guess the question is, is there enough, and are they well enough trained? Because you've got somebody coming in as a home care person. It's one thing if the senior simply has a physical problem, but if they've got dementia or if they've got memory issues, so is the training there? And from your perspective, kind of. What's needed in order for people to stay at home, which is everybody's goal. I want to stay at home.
There's definitely a huge need for home care out here. I noticed that when I was working at the nursing home. Some of our residents weren't able to return home because the home care wasn't available.
So it wasn't there. So they could have otherwise returned home with some home care.
Yeah, if they had the appropriate care.
But it wasn't, because of course the kids don't live here. Not in all cases, right?
Or they have their own. That's the biggest thing too, as a geriatric care manager, is one of my main goals is to make sure that the children and the parents maintain that child-parent relationship and don't get stressed out and frustrated with each other, because the children are in that sandwich generation where they have a job and their own children to worry about on top of their parents. So it becomes very stressful.
Yeah, I remember once talking to a client who was she was dying. She had cancer, so she moved to a hospice residence. It was this wonderful hospice residence. And it was a double, right? So there was her, and then the next room was her daughter who moved in, right? And it cost something, But I talked to the daughter afterwards, after the mother died, and she said, it was just great. Because I got to be there as the daughter. I wasn't there as the nurse. I wasn't there as the homemaker. Mm-hmm. I was there as the daughter, right? Which was, so I got to spend this time with my daughter. I just mentioned that because you bring that up, and I kind of not thought about that, the toll that takes if you're the child caregiver.
Oh, yeah.
Or if you're the child geriatric care, if you're the child in Colorado who's calling in to the caregiver or the mother and trying to make sure somebody is there. And now, but by the way, you've got a day job because you probably got a job and you got kids.
Right.
So the notion of figuring that out just in order to allow the family members to stay as family members.
Exactly.
It's just like really important.
And then giving them, using a geriatric care manager, you have that one stop shop. Everything goes through that geriatric care manager, all the communication. You don't have to call the physical therapist and then call the home care agency and the doctor.
And everybody else.
We can do that for you.
And everybody else.
Yeah, but back to the home care, that is something I'm working on with Best of Care since they have a home care agency off island.
Yeah.
So I'm in the process of hiring home health aides.
And there are other folks, right? And there are some other home care agencies here. I know there's Anodyne. I know there's
Nantucket Home Health Care.
And there's Nantucket Home Health Care. Yeah.
I want to say that's it though.
They're on a whole lot. They're on a whole lot of home care agencies. Yeah.
Personally think it's very important for families to go through an actual agency because then you know that your aides are completely trained because we have to follow regulations. They're background checked, Corey checked,
right.
And the whole payroll, because that can become a big thing. So you know that's all.
Oh, huge.
Written down, and there's one other thing, but.
No, I know, and I know that there's an entity, there's a group that does a lot of stuff on the Vineyard. I'm always supposed to say the other island that does stuff on the other islands. It's called SOSTEC, and they kind of try to connect up specifically folks with 24-hour caregivers, right? But try to do some of that, do the vetting and all of that jazz. Because once again, you're looking for someone, and you go, well, kind of where do I look? You know,
right.
And you're a senior, or you're in Colorado. You're the daughter in Colorado, so trying to figure that stuff out is going to be just murder.
Yeah.
So you talked about also transportation needs. From your experience, is this really an issue here?
I'm not sure as much on Nantucket. I feel like Nantucket has such a great community where people are willing to help out one another. But I would say those Nantucketers who are leaving the island to go to the Cape or go to Boston, because renting a car is so expensive. Getting in a cab is $50 one way.
Right.
So just having that availability.
Figuring that out.
Yeah.
Figuring that out. So I'm just going to mention one other thing about the other island, right? Because I think one of the goals of the show is to also kind of talk about ways that other people have tried to deal with this, right? Is they have there's a group called the Center for Living, the Martha's Vineyard Center for Living. They run the Memory Cafe, among other things. They have, by the way, they're now weekly. They're so popular that they're weekly. And I just mentioned this because I think there are some similarities between the islands. They have music every week, and it's all volunteer because there are so many musicians on the island, so many retired people, right, who are musicians, right? And they average about 30 people a week. It's like this astonishing thing. But the other thing that they have is they run a medical taxi service, and they coordinate it all, right?
I actually just reached out to them about that.
And about the medical taxi?
Yeah, yesterday. And apparently, they had to turn that over to the bus route.
To Vineyard Transit Authority, the VTA.
Funding. So I don't really know how that's working
out. Oh, no, that's interesting.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
So I have to reach out, I have to reach back out to her because I wanted to figure out if we could do something together and work together as the islands. But
by the way, I think that they have some things to learn from here, and I think you folks have some. But what's so great is that the two of you are cooperating, right, in terms of looking for funding off island, right? It's a great sell. Because it's the two islands, right? And everybody acknowledges that they're kind of really unique populations. So I think that could really take off, right? So listen, thanks for coming on and talking about like a whole bunch of different things, right? So I think having the geriatric care management stuff, for folks to be aware of that, and maybe we can ask the folks here to do something in terms of like a banner or something, just so they know if they need to contact you.
Yeah, that'd be great.
And talking about the Memory Cafe, the notion of people being aware that that may be coming, and also of people being aware they may get hit up for a little bit of money. And once again, when we're talking about money for the Memory Cafe, I remember the numbers being thrown around as like $10,000 for a year, or $15,000. This is like not big money, right?
It's a good cause.
The interesting thing about dealing with senior issues as opposed is that it isn't like this is some unusual set of people. This is like you when you get older, right? It's either you now or it's you later, but it's you. So supporting these things is just really, really important.
We're all going to be there one day.
We're all going to be there. And thank you very, very much for tuning in today. I hope you enjoyed this presentation with my friend Erin Kopecki, and we look forward to seeing you on the next installment of Frank and Mary on Nantucket.